female, for all of you are one in Christ Jesus. We are children of God through faith. Our opening hymn is number 652, 1 and 2.
We will light a light in the name of God, who is the creator of all life. We will light a light in the name of the Son, who gives us new life. And we will light a light in the name of the Spirit, whose presence makes all creation holy. Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O Lord, make us have perpetual love and reverence for your holy name, for you never fail to help and govern those whom you have sent upon the sure foundation of your loving kindness. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. Amen. Let us prepare ourselves to hear the word of God as it comes to us in the reading of Holy Scriptures. Our hearts and minds are open.
reading from the book of Isaiah. I was ready to be sought out by those who did not ask, to be found by those who did not seek me. I said, "Here I am, here I am," to a nation that did not call on my name. I held out my hands all day long to a rebellious people who walk in a way that is not good, following their own devices, a people who provoke me to my face continually, sacrificing in gardens and offering incense on bricks, who sit inside tombs and spend the night in secret places, who eat swine's flesh with broth of abominable things in their vessels, who say, "Keep to yourself, do not come near me, for I am too holy for you." These are a smoke in my nostrils, a fire that burns all day long. See, it is written before me, "I will not keep silent, but I will repay. I will indeed repay into those laps their iniquities and their ancestors' iniquities together," says the Lord. "Because they offered incense on the mountains and reviled me on the hills, I will measure into their laps full payment for their actions. Thus says the Lord, as the wine is found in the cluster and they say, 'Do not destroy it, for there is a blessing in it,' so I will do for my servant's sake and not destroy them all. I will bring forth descendants from Jacob and from Judah, inheritors of my mountains. My chosen shall inherit it, and my servants shall settle there." For the word of God in Scripture, for the word of God among us, for the word of God within us, we give you thanks, O God. Please read Psalm number 22. "Be not far away, O Lord. You are my strength. Hasten to help me. Save me from the sword, my life from the power of the dog. Save me from the lion's mouth, my wretched body from the horns of wild bulls. I will declare your name to my brethren in the midst of thy congregation. I will praise you. Praise the Lord, you that fear him and stand in awe of him, O offspring of Israel. All you of Jacob's line, give glory, for he does not despise nor abhor the poor in their poverty, neither does he hide his face from them. But when they cry to him, he hears them. My praises of him in the great assembly. I will perform my vows in the presence of those who worship him. The poor shall eat and be satisfied, and those who seek the Lord shall praise him. May your heart live forever. All the ends of the earth shall remember and turn to the Lord, and all the families of the nations shall bow before him. The kingship belongs to the Lord. He rules over the nations."
A reading from the letter of Paul to the Galatians. "Now, before faith came, we were imprisoned and guarded under the law until faith would be revealed. Therefore, the law was our disciplinarian until Christ came, so that we might be justified by faith. But now that faith has come, we are no longer subject to a disciplinarian. For in Christ Jesus, you are all children of God through faith. As many of you as were baptized into Christ have clothed yourselves with Christ. There is no longer Jew or Greek. There is no longer slave or free. There is no longer male or female. For all of you are one in Christ. And if you belong in Christ, then you are Abraham's offspring, heirs according to the promise. For the word of God in Scripture, for the word of God among us, for the word of God within us.
We give you thanks, O God.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Luke.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Jesus and his disciples arrived at the country of the Gerasenes, which is opposite Galilee. As Jesus stepped out on land, a man of the city who had demons met him. For a long time he had worn no clothes, and he did not live in a house, but in the tombs. When he saw Jesus, he fell down before him and shouted at the top of his voice, "What have you to do with me, Jesus, Son of the Most High God? I beg you, do not torment me." For Jesus had commanded the unclean spirit to come out of the man. For many times it had seized him, and he was kept under guard and bound with chains and shackles. But he would break the bonds and be driven by the demons into the wilds. Jesus then said to him, "What is your name?" He said, "Legion," for the many demons that had entered him. They begged him not to order them back to go back into the abyss. Now there on the hillside, a large herd of swine were feeding, and the demons begged Jesus to let them enter these. So he gave them permission. Then the demons came out of the man and entered the swine, and the herd rushed down the steep bank into the lake and were drowned. When the swineherds saw what had happened, they ran off and told it to the city and in the country. And then people came out to see what had happened, and when they came to Jesus, they found the man from whom the demons had gone sitting at the feet of Jesus, clothed and in his right mind. And they were afraid. Those who had seen it told them how the one who had been possessed by demons had been healed. Then all the people of the surrounding country of the Gerasenes asked Jesus to leave them, for they were seized with great fear. So he got into the boat and returned. And the man from whom the demons had gone begged that he might go with him. But Jesus sent him away, saying, "Return to your home and declare how much God has done for you." So he went away, proclaiming throughout the city how much Jesus had done for him. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
In the name of one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, amen. Amen. Please be seated. This week, as I was studying and preparing my sermon for today, news headlines reminded me that the war rages on in the Ukraine, and there seems no end in sight. My mind was drawn back then to the most recent school shooting in Texas. And I said a prayer for my own children. And then, ping, went my phone. And I read of another church shooting, this time at St. Stephen's Episcopal Church in Vestavia Hills, Alabama. I can't even begin to describe to you how sad my heart felt, how heavy my mind wanted to numb itself to the pain of the realities of our world. In these moments when harsh realities and brutalities overwhelm us, it can be easy to believe that we need to retreat or alienate ourselves in some way. We can feel overwhelmed with exhaustion or fear. Now, most of you, I dare say, are familiar with a condition we now know as PTSD, post-traumatic stress disorder. But clinicians now describe a condition sometimes associated with PTSD as moral injury. Our U.S. Department of Veteran Affairs defines moral injury in this way. Moral injury is the distressing psychological, behavioral, social, and sometimes spiritual aftermath to such events. Moral injury can occur in response to acting or witnessing behaviors that go against an individual's values and moral beliefs. Moral injury also typically has an impact on an individual's spirituality. For example, an individual suffering from moral injury may have difficulty understanding how one's beliefs and relationship with a higher power can be true, given the horrific events this person experienced, leading to uncertainty about previously held spiritual beliefs. And I have citation if anyone wants to go home and look up that further. We may think this condition is limited to veterans or prisoners of war, but it is not so limited. Someone who has witnessed abuse in the home or violence in their own neighborhood can also suffer with this condition. In fact, we are all potentially subject to moral injury given the plethora of natural disasters and exposures to the violence seen on any media coverage. So how can we keep our faith that God is with us in terrible times? I believe the scriptures we have read this morning, both the text from Isaiah and the text from Luke, speak to just such a faith. Because both of these texts tell the stories of people who have witnessed and lived through terrible life events, and they're struggling to keep faith. Isaiah was one of the prophets during the Babylonian time of captivity. He and the people that he spoke to, that he gave the prophetic word of God to, they all knew the horrors of war, to be made captives and led into exile and alienation from their land. Isaiah speaks God's promise to this people living in a foreign land, struggling to understand, where is God in all of this? And yet we hear this morning that the Lord promised to continue to the generations of his people and return them once again to their inheritance. Jumping through history a few millennia, in Luke we read about Jesus entering the country of the Gerasenes. Now the people who were reading Luke's letter, if you will, the original letter, they knew exactly that reference to this Gerasene country all too well. We might not know that history. During the first Jewish war, which was from 66 to 71 AD, the city of Gerasa and its surrounding villages were completely destroyed by the Roman army, That would be the country of the Gerasenes. Luke, who wrote his gospel sometime between 80 and 90 AD. So therefore, Luke is telling a story back now, but of a person, a man, who might have actually been a child or a teenager during that first Jewish war. This is a man that is now living in isolation among the tombs. He was angry. He was known to inflict self-harm and to harm others who tried to subdue him. All his behaviors have alienated him from his friends and his family. And Luke opens the gospel this morning with Jesus coming ashore and is immediately met by this man. I find it intriguing that Luke records the demon's name as legions, the same word used to describe the largest unit of Roman troops, the same legions of 3,000 to 6,000 soldiers that not 15 years earlier had destroyed the people of Gerasa. Both the stories from the book of the prophet and from Luke tell of individuals carrying within them the traumatic weight of mass, generational, and systemic oppression. Both these stories beg the question, how do we keep our faith in the midst of such tragedies? Can we seek and find God when we can't seem to find the answers to explain the horrors before us? And I believe both those scriptures from today remind us that God promises completely to be with us in the midst of tragedy, to comfort us, to bring us into the inheritance that God has promised for God's people. This is when and how Jesus meets us on the shores of life, surrounded by tombs, the reminders of our own mortality. As the Holy Word clearly gives God's promise to us, then the real question today is not where is God in tragedy, but how do we respond in faith to tragedy? We have a choice. We can act and respond without faith, like the villagers did in the gospel account. When the villagers came to see for themselves what has happened, instead of being thankful and rejoicing that one of their members has been healed and restored unto himself, they are afraid. And they insist that Jesus leave. Because if this man has been completely healed and he has gained his freedom from all the terrors that had once bound him and oppressed him, then word might get out. He might start spreading the good news, and the Roman authorities might come because they fear another rebellion. See, safe places created for healing and redemption return health, dignity, and power to people. Empowered, healthy people tend to want to work for more change and more healing and for more empowered people. People in power don't usually like to give power away. You can see why the villagers were afraid. Now today, praise be to God, we do understand mental illnesses and addictions better. And we continue to learn more and discover new ways to treat people who struggle with such illnesses. Yet, the truth is, as a human race, we are often still afraid of mental illness. We don't talk about it. That's taboo. We misunderstand illnesses and the illness of addiction. And therefore, we judge or shun or avoid people who might be struggling with these illnesses. But as the people of God, our baptismal creed teaches us that all people are children of God. We promise that with God's help, we will seek and serve Christ in all persons. Love our neighbors as ourselves. We will strive for justice and peace among all people and respect the dignity of every human being. There are no conditions on which people. All people belong to God. So this morning, I leave us with questions to ponder throughout this week. How can we make space in our hearts to be honest with ourselves and avoid judgment or making judgments on others? Can we help create safe places and embody incarnational love for our fellow neighbors? How might we be advocates who work with our local and state legislators to provide funding and services for our veterans, survivors of abuse, trafficking, or refugees from war and torn places? Where might God be asking you to respond in faith to tragedy? And when this week will we have the opportunity to reassure someone that God promises to be with them in the midst of their pain, to comfort us, and to bring us into that blessed inheritance that He has promised for everyone?
We believe in God above us, maker and sustainer of all life, of sun and moon, water and earth, of male and female. We believe in God beside us, Jesus Christ, the Word made flesh, born of a woman, servant of the poor, tortured and nailed to a cross, a man of sorrows, He died forsaken. Descended into the earth, to the place of death. On the third day He rose from the tomb, and He ascended into heaven to be everywhere present, and His kingdom will come on earth. We believe in God within us, the Holy Spirit of Pentecostal fire, life-giving breath of the church, spirit of healing and forgiveness, source of resurrection and of eternal life. Amen.
In peace, let us pray to the Lord, saying, Lord, have mercy. For the church throughout the world, that we may follow Christ our head and be blameless in living the gospel of reconciliation, we pray especially for Carla, Richard, Dick, and Lisa, and Michael, Dabney, and Douglas. In our diocesan cycle of prayer, we pray for St. Michael's and All Angels, Sanibel, St. Monica's, Naples, St. Nathaniel's, Northport, St. Paul's, Naples, and Wesley Chapel, St. Peter's Cathedral in St. Petersburg, and St. Peter's in Plant City. In our Anglican cycle of prayer, we pray for the province of the Episcopal Church of South Sudan. Let us pray to the Lord. For the nations of the world, that all may live without fear of oppression, poverty, and war, guide us through the love you reveal to establish the justice you proclaimed, that all peoples might dwell in harmony and peace, united by the one love that binds us to each other and to you. Let us pray to the Lord. For the earth, that we may wisely use its resources for the benefit of mankind and offer whatever help wherever natural disaster has fractured human trust in the goodness of creation. We pray especially for the area around Yellowstone National Park and the city of Gardner, Montana. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
We pray for leaders of the nations, that they may honor justice and protect the weak and serve the common good. We pray for Joseph, our president, and Ron, our governor, and for those in the military, Miguel, Charles, Travis, Mike, Dennis, Matt, and Jake. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For our communities and neighborhoods, that they all may dwell in harmony. We pray for our outreach ministries, Crafters for Hope, Shore, St. Wilfred's Food Pantry, and Ashton Elementary School. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For our enemies, that we may find reconciliation with them for the sake of Christ, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For those who are sick and in trouble, that they may find healing and peace, we pray for Terry, Don, Chelsea, Coquina, Elaine, Emily, Ann, Jackie, Jan, Kimberly, Karen, Natasha, Myra, Zeke, Elizabeth, Sarome, Carol, Ed and Edie, Bobby, Heather, and Christopher. And for Jean, Claudia, Chris, Jamie, Crystal, Linda, and Melanie. Let us pray to the Lord. Eternal God of love, we know that you do not willingly inflict pain upon or grieve your children, and your dream for all is abundant life. We come to you now in sorrow and sadness at the death of Bart, Sarah, and Jane, and the violence inflicted on our siblings at St. Stephen's Church in Vestavia Hills, Alabama. Receive the souls of those who have died. Grant them peace in your arms of love. Be with those who are injured and suffer, those who are grieving, and those who are frightened and dispirited. Help us as a nation to find ways to bring an end to the scourge of violence, which hurts your children and your human family. Give us the strength we need, the courage we must have, and the faith in you that will see us through. All this we pray and ask in the name of the Prince of Peace, your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen.
And on Father's Day, we give thanks to God for the divine gift of fatherhood in all its diverse forms. Let us pray for all fathers among us today, for our own fathers, those living and those who have passed away, for the fathers who loved us, and for those who fell short of loving us fully, for those who hope to be fathers someday, and for those whose hope to have children has been frustrated, for all fathers who have lost children, for all men and women who have been fathers to others in any way, those who have been our substitute fathers, and we who have done so for others in need. We pray this through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Merciful God, hear the prayers of your people, offered in steadfast faith and hope in your care for us. For we ask these things in the name of Christ. Amen. Let us continue with a growing in the Spirit prayer. Almighty and ever-living God, source of all wisdom and understanding, be present with us as we consider the rule and mission of our congregation. Teach us your honor and glory. Guide us by your Holy Spirit to perceive what is right, and grant us strength and courage to receive it, and the grace to accomplish it through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Trusting in the mercy of God, let us confess our sin to God and to one another. Merciful and gracious God, we walk in a way that is not
Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen. God makes peace within us. And God makes peace between us. Peace be with you.
Good morning, everybody. Couple of announcements. I'm going to go first. So thank you to Sue Lamastro. While you are traveling this summer, when you stay at hotels, be generous with what you take from what they offer. We're going to take, these are all the hotel toiletries. Take them, you know, see if you can't get them to be more generous. Bring them back in the fall. We will put these into individual toiletry kits and get them over to Resurrection House so that people have toiletries to use. Today is the third Sunday of the month, so of course our outreach basket is out. Please, I ask you to be generous. Summer tends to be a time that things are a little quieter, but the needs over at St. Wilfrid's and the needs of our comfort bags are still great. So thank you.
I would like to welcome you, especially if you are visiting with us today. Let me just introduce myself real quickly. I'm the Reverend Carla McCook, and I'm the rector here at St. Margaret of Scotland Episcopal Church. You just met our deacon, Lisa Parker. It's okay. And our assisting clergy is Father Dick Mahaffey, our deaf missioner for the diocese. So we all welcome you, and we hope that you'll stay and have some fellowship time with us following our service this morning. Reminder that this Wednesday, the outreach committee is going to meet, correct? Where's Sue? There's Sue. Yes, correct? 1 o'clock is the time for that meeting, okay? And this Wednesday evening will be our last worship on Wednesdays for the summer, and we'll begin again in mid-August, okay? All baptized persons are welcome to receive the sacrament in our church this morning. So the way that works is we come out of our rows, and the ushers will invite you. We make a single file line, and then when you come here, you get a choice. So, if you would prefer to have intinction or dip the bread into the wine, the clergy person will do that for you, and then they will place it in your open hand. That is this side. When it comes to communion, you'll see on the screen it says, in tinction, you go this way. If you would prefer to drink from the chalice or not receive the wine, you would receive the body, but not the wine. So you're drinking or passing. You come this way. You may also prefer to receive just a blessing, and we welcome you to come forward. If you come to the rail, either side, one of us as clergy will bless you with a short prayer on your head. Okay? Good. Offer to God a sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. Make good your vows in a moment to the Most High. Did I miss something? Oh, I forgot to bless the bags. Well, we have done the offertory. Let me do another blessing and then I'll give it to the choir, okay? Sorry. Out of sight, out of mind. Especially when I'm working in two languages at the same time. It's really hard to hold it all in there. Okay. We have several more bags of care for our cancer centers all around Sarasota. We now serve seven different places. So they are always calling and asking, we need more bags, we need more bags. So let us bless these and remember those that we pray for. Almighty God, we entrust all who are dear to us to your never-failing care and love and healing power for this life and in the life to come, knowing that you are always doing better for them the things than we could hope or imagine or desire. This we pray through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Bless these gifts, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. I'm sorry. Thank you. be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
Lift them to the Lord.
For it is truly right and a good and joyful to give you thanks, all holy God, source of life and fountain of mercy. For you have filled us and all creation with your blessing, and you have fed us with your constant love. You have redeemed us in Jesus Christ, and you knit us into one body. Through your Spirit, you replenish us and call us to the fullness of life. Therefore, joining with angels and archangels and with the faithful of every generation, we lift our voices with all creation as we sing. Blessed are you, gracious God, creator of the universe and the giver of life. You formed us in your own image, and you called us to dwell in your infinite love. You gave the world into our care that we might be your faithful stewards and show forth your bountiful grace. But we failed to honor your image in one another and in ourselves. We would not see your goodness in the world around us. And so we violated your creation, we abused one another, and we rejected your love. Yet you have never ceased to care for us. You prepared the way of salvation for all people. Through Abraham and Sarah, you called us into covenant with you. You delivered us from slavery. You sustained us in the wilderness. And you raised up prophets to renew your promise of salvation. Then, in the fullness of time, you sent your eternal word, made mortal flesh in Jesus, born into the human family, dwelling among us, he revealed your glory, and giving himself freely unto death on the cross, he triumphed over evil, opening the way of freedom and life. On the night before he died for us, our Savior, Jesus Christ, took bread, and when he had given thanks to you, he broke it, gave it to his friends, and he said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." As supper was ending, Jesus took the cup of wine. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is poured out for you and for all for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith.
Christ has died, Christ is risen, and Christ will come again. Remembering his death and resurrection, we now present to you from your creation this bread and this wine. By your Holy Spirit, may these be for us the body and blood of our Savior Jesus Christ. Grant that we who share these gifts may be filled with the Holy Spirit and live as Christ's body in the world. Bring us into the everlasting heritage of your daughters and sons, that with the Virgin Mary, Margaret, and all of your saints, past, present, and yet to come, we may praise your name forever. Through Christ, with Christ, and in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, to you be honor, glory, and praise forever and ever. Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil, for thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The living bread is broken for the life of the world. Lord, unite us in this sign. These are the gifts of God for the people of God. Take them in remembrance that Christ died for you. Feed on him in your heart by faith and with thanksgiving. and Lisa. In the name of this congregation, we send you out bearing these holy gifts, that those to whom you go may share with us in the communion of Christ's body and blood. We who are many are one body, because we all share one bread and one cup. Amen. And thank you. Let us pray. Lord Jesus Christ, you have put your life into our hands, and now we put our lives into yours. Take us, renew us, remake us. What we have been, past, what we shall be through you still awaits us. Lead us on, take us with you. Amen. Wherever we go, may the joy of God the gracious
be with us.
Wherever we go, may the face of Christ the kindly
be with us.
Wherever we go, may the compassing of the Spirit of grace
be with us.
May the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and his Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you and remain with you always. Amen.
Go in peace to love and serve the Lord.